no reason why, out on the street, today a civilian should be carrying a loaded weapon.
On May 2nd, 1967, two dozen men and six women marched into the California State Capitol building in Sacramento. They were carrying pistols, shotguns, and rifles. But this was not a SWAT team or a security force, at least not a government one. In fact, this heavily armed group was more of a well-regulated militia. And they'd come to the Capitol that day to try to stop the legislature and the state's Republican governor from passing a law that would strip them of their ability to openly carry their weapons as they patrolled the streets of their neighborhoods in an effort to keep people safe.
They put trumped-up charges of conspiracy and felonies on everyone who went in to exercise a constitutional right and said they had no right to bear arms in a public place. The California Penal Code Section 12020 through 12027 and also the Second Amendment of the Constitution guarantees the citizen a right to bear arms on public property.
Now, it may come as a surprise to some of you, given today's discourse on guns, that the National Rifle Association and the Republican governor of California, Ronald Reagan, came out passionately in an effort to strip this militia's right to carry arms.
But I would think that some of the bills that have been suggested, such as not carrying a loaded weapon on a city street or in town, this might certainly be a good one.
Why was Ronald Reagan so up in arms? After all, California was an open carry state. These Americans were exercising their God-given Second Amendment rights. So what was the problem?
Am I under arrest? Take your hands off me if I'm not under arrest.
That militia that marched into the Capitol that day was the Black Panther Party. And the street patrols that they were engaged in were operations to protect their communities from the police and other government forces that had been targeting, abusing, and killing Black people.
The Black Panther Party for Self-Defense calls upon the American people in general and the Black people in particular to take full note of the racist California legislature, which is now considering legislation aimed at keeping the Black people disarmed and powerless at the very same time that racist police agencies throughout the country are intensifying the terror, brutality, murder, and repression of Black people.
California lawmakers were terrified. Some reportedly hid under their desks. The entire establishment, including the gun lobby, denounced these armed Black people. And the bill, which became known as the Panther Bill, was aimed at taking away what the NRA and the Republicans portrayed as their sacred rights as Americans. In fact, the Panthers in the Capitol that day were charged with felonies.
FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover today asserted that the Black Panthers represent the greatest internal threat to the nation. Hoover said the Panthers have perpetrated numerous assaults on police and have engaged in violent confrontations throughout the country.
The so-called Panther Bill made one thing abundantly clear. Having armed Black revolutionaries patrolling their neighborhoods with weapons was a greater threat than losing the right to openly carry weapons for everyone in California. In fact, this bill resulted in some of the strictest gun control laws anywhere in the United States, all because some Black Americans exercised their right to carry loaded weapons. Now, around that same time, major media outlets were aghast as Malcolm X called on Black people to arm themselves and to defend themselves against racist violence.
In areas where the police, whether it be federal, state, or city, have proven their inability or their unwillingness to defend Negroes, the lives and the property of Negroes, then it's only intelligent and it's only right that Negroes protect themselves, and I have encouraged them to buy a rifle and a shotgun, which according to the Constitution is legal.
For what purpose?
So that at any time anyone makes any effort whatsoever to brutalize them or attack them or endanger them, they should have something to defend themselves.
The history of this reaction by white media to Black gun ownership is a very telling one, because it reveals that the sanctity of the Second Amendment for all Americans is a myth. It's a myth today, and it's been a myth from the beginning. The real history of gun laws in the United States is not about hunting, and it's not about fighting tyranny. For the most part, if we're really being honest, It's been about white people having the right to bear arms and use them against black people, indigenous people, and other not real Americans. Just to put this in perspective, more than 80% of gun owners in the United States today are white, and the majority of those are men. And it's no coincidence that gun sales skyrocketed during the administration of the first black president of the United States.
You might have met our fresh-faced flower child president and his weak-kneed Ivy League friends, but you haven't met America. You haven't met the heartland, where the people will defend this nation with their bloody, calloused, bare hands. That's what it takes.
Here's the thing. The Second Amendment is not in danger, and it wasn't in danger during Obama's time in office. In the so-called debate around guns in the United States, the Second Amendment is treated as sacrosanct by both Democrats and Republicans. Yes, there are wide differences in opinion. Some Democrats want all assault weapons banned. Others say that the Second Amendment is really about hunting or sport or just for the defense of your home. But almost all major party politicians support keeping the Second Amendment on the books.
First of all, I support the Second Amendment. I lived in Arkansas for 18 wonderful years. I represented upstate New York. I understand and respect the tradition of gun ownership. It goes back to the founding of our country.
The Washington consensus is that the Second Amendment is set in stone, and we just need to tweak various laws and regulations, make sure that the bad guys don't get guns or that certain guns shouldn't be gettable. But that's all that's really being debated. Here's Obama after being confronted by a gun enthusiast at a town hall meeting at the end of his presidency.
There have been more guns sold since I've been president than just about any time in U.S. history. And at no point have I ever proposed confiscating guns from responsible gun owners.
Back in the 1990s, the conservative Supreme Court Chief Justice Warren Burger broke with orthodoxy on this issue, and he said that the modern interpretation of the Second Amendment was a dangerous joke.
If I were writing the Bill of Rights now, there wouldn't be any such thing as the Second Amendment. This has been the subject of one of the greatest pieces of fraud. I repeat the word fraud on the American public by special interest groups that I have ever seen in my lifetime.
But what's the actual history, the historical context behind the Second Amendment? That's a question we rarely hear discussed in our society. And the NRA, it's basically just one massive dog whistle about white people protecting themselves from dangerous non-white people, and more recently from Antifa and protesters and opponents of Donald Trump. And, well, let's actually hear it from Dana Loesch of the NRA herself.
They use their media to assassinate real news. They use their schools to teach children that their president is another Hitler. They use their movie stars and singers and comedy shows and award shows to repeat their narrative over and over again. And then they use their ex-president to endorse the resistance, all to make them march, make them protest, make them scream racism and sexism and xenophobia and homophobia, to smash windows, burn cars, shut down interstates and airports, bully and terrorize the law-abiding, until the only option left is for the police to do their jobs and stop the madness.
That message from the NRA is a direct descendant of the same mentality that has been a staple of white supremacy throughout the history of the United States. The real Americans need weapons to protect themselves from the savages. Gun rights in this country were forged on the idea that white people had the right to take Native people's land by the barrel of the gun. They were forged on the idea that black people were living pieces of property that needed to be kept in place by armed slave patrols, militias, and posse justice. No matter what your position on guns is, the Second Amendment stems from an ideology that is rooted in the belief that white people have the right to control others with their weapons. As historian Roxanne Dunbar Ortiz put it, the Constitution is the sacred text of the civic religion that is U.S. nationalism. And that nationalism is inexorably tied to white supremacy.